Hello everyone, welcome back. Today I want to talk about service creation and what I can bring in the REST area to the table with my plugins. Before we start, we are now on Windows. I've switched over. That's not a limitation that it only runs on Windows. I just wanted to show that the toolchain runs on different operating systems. Yep. So let's get started. We already have our development environment running. Webpack is already running. The application works, as you can see here. I can jump between the views. I can go back to my main page, as you can see here. Yep. Also, the page we created in the last videos is online. Yeah, that's it. So, usually, you break the Unix of execution functionality wise into modules. I'm now going to create a new module with the create module functionality here. This opens this dialog here. Let's make it a little bit smaller. We have the module name here. Then we can export the module. This is sort of a placeholder for Angular 2 in our case. As I explained before, then we can create a sane directory structure. If we don't check that one, only the module file is generated. But, we can create it in a new directory. If we don't check that one, then just the module file is generated in the current directory. And if not, then a directory is created according to the module name. And if we check the last one, create module structure, then we get a sane directory structure with a separate directory for views, for controllers, for services, for DTOs, and for the rest. I think we leave it as is at the moment and call it, let's see, module 4 is already reserved, module 5. The module has been generated. Let's quickly add the files to Git because we have versioning underneath already. Now we have the module 5 directory. The module 5 is defined as usual with the ng-module annotation. And here this is fallback to the old Angular system. You can use this variable, for instance, to add components the usual Angular way. But normally we don't use that anymore. We just stick to our annotated module here. And if you go back to our main module, let's have a look. The module 5 here is already registered. So there's no boilerplate code involved, which we had to write. Everything was generated as usual. Now let's have a look at the directory structure. We have a separate directory for components, for data transfer objects, for pages, for services, and a shared library folder where you can put some shared code in, which is shared over the entire module. Yeah, then let's quickly add another page. You have already seen that. Page 5 for whatever it is. Page 1. Hello from page 5. Yeah, let's export that one. That's okay. Let's add it to Git. We have it here now. Then let's quickly add a root. Now page 5 is updated in the roots, as you can see here. We copy quickly the root link as usual, go to page 1, edit here. Yeah, let's de-edit it a little bit. Go give it a meaningful label. I also have to explain, I don't have a script here. So I really am doing this on the fly. If I stumble into a big bug, then I usually stop the video, fix the bug and start the recording again. So this is really on the fly, and sometimes smaller mistakes can happen. And of course, English is not my... Oops, sorry. That was one of those mistakes. I was too concentrated on talking to you. Yep. I'm doing this on the fly, and sometimes smaller mistakes can happen. And of course, English is not really my native language. As you might have noticed, my accent is really strong. I wasn't aware of that myself, but it is. In fact, German in an Austrian variation is my mother tongue. I'm Austrian. Yeah. So, smaller mistakes can happen. I'm running into smaller bugs along the way. And if there's really a big bug, I take note of it, fix it right away, start the recording again. Yeah. That's the way it works. We're done here now. We have wired in the page 5. It was, including talking, a 2-minute job. Without talking, probably 20 seconds or 30 seconds. And we're on page 5. Now, compare that to what you would have to do without any tool chain. We would have had to create the page manually. We would have had lots of boilerplate code here. We would have had to create the template. We would have had to write the root, had to edit. We would have had to write the links and so on. My personal guess is we are down from roughly, including bug fixing, 30 minutes, or maybe 20 if we're fast, down to 30 seconds. And if we do talking like that, maybe maybe a minute or two, yeah. It's really a time saver. And one of the reasons why I programmed this was simply because I saw that I spent about 30% of my time writing boilerplate code. Fixing bugs while I was writing boilerplate codes, which were in the boilerplate code, and I really wanted to cut down on the time. It was hitting my nerves, and I basically needed the time for other things. I wanted to concentrate myself on the implementation, not on the framework. And moving up to Angular 2, as I said, was not possible at that moment. Angular 2 was not ready. I didn't have the budget to move up for the time being, so I'm still on Angular 1 in my bigger projects. And maybe in 1 or 2 years, when Google support runs out, we are going the transition route, then I really also have to look at the tools which I can use to move the code up. Maybe I will integrate some tools in here. I have some ideas. Yeah, let's see what the future brings. Okay. So our first page is generated. Now to the more interesting part. We have some application logic here, or we need some application logic here. Let's go back to page 5. Let's do it the navigational way. And now we could add the business logic in here. That's a really, really bad idea. If you've ever done bigger systems, you know why. Because once the business logic changes a lot, the user interface changes a lot, and if you wire everything in here, you get a huge, unmaintainable, big blob. For that, Angular introduced the multi-tier, maybe it was before, I'm not really up to the latest knowledge regarding all the web frameworks there are, but I really like the idea that Angular introduced a multi-tiered approach on the client level as well, by splitting off the client business logic code also into services. This also eases the integration with backend services by giving us a neutral communication and business logic layer. Yeah, let's get started with the services. If you've programmed with Angular, which I assume you have done, otherwise you wouldn't have had a look at the video on how to cut down on your time, you're familiar with services. They're basically singletons. Angular also introduces other types of services like the factories, which are generated on the fly. But for the time being, we are going to stick with the singleton services because I have annotation support for that. If you want to use the other services, you can use them, but you have to fall back to the Angular 1 registration, which I showed you before. There's still a way. Yep. So let's create a service. That's, again, very easy. We just mark the folder, right mouse button, create service. Now we just have to give it a meaningful name. My first service. Yeah, let's export it. It doesn't matter anyway here. Angular 1 doesn't have module isolation. So the service is generated. As we can see, we use the standardized injectable annotation. Due to Angular 1 constraints, we have to give it a name. And then get say hello. We add a getter here for the say hello property. That's also one of the nice things about TypeScript and also of JavaScript, of course. Compared to Java, we have real class properties, which means we just define the properties as public, and if we want to override them, we just define getters and setters, and we don't break any outside code. Java still has the approach of enforcing setters and getters, which already was an anti-pattern when Java was introduced. I was at Java 1 1999, or maybe it was 2000, in my first job I had, and even then, the question was asked, are we going to get class properties? Are they going to be introduced? Java was, I think, around 1.0, 1.1 or so. And the compiler developers, I don't think it was James Gosling back then, but it was one of the developers said they were going to look into that. Now, fast forward, we are now 2018. Java still is around, still live and kicking. It has improved a lot. But we still have setters and getters. Of course, there's Lampark, but Lampark is not the ideal solution because it's an external library. Sometimes it's forbidden. It has some pitfalls, like never ever use the data annotation unless you really know what you do, because it generates the hash code and the clone methods on the fly, and that might be a pitfall for some people who really need the functionality. Specialized, yep. But overall, it's worthwhile to use Lampark on top of Java unless you want to move to Kotlin or any other saner language in this area. Yeah, that's it. I mean, I really love properties and I've always loved them. Back into those object Turbo Pascal days, they already had those way before Java. Yeah, and Java is really lacking in this area, but that's like talking to walls for decades. Said that many, many times, and well, usually Java developers say nobody really needs that, we can generate the setters and getters anyway, but in the end, you end up with hundreds of lines in the worst case of boilerplate code, where your important overrides are hidden under really lots of auto-generated code, and in the end, you won't find it anymore. So there is really an advantage of not generating all this code yourself. Okay, I went away a little bit too far now. Let's generate to say hello here. Back to the topic. Hello from my first service. Yeah, we forgot about the string as return parameter. Now we are back to normal. Now let's go back to our page. How are we going to wire the service in? I really took a lesson here from Angular 2, which allowed type-safe injections, which I also really like because it helps refactoring tools, it helps to avoid errors. And to avoid typing here, I have a set of live templates integrated into the plugin. They all start with TC. And here we can choose TC serve inject full, which means type safe service injection from the clipboard, a full inject. You will see what that means. Now we have the anti-injection in a sane manner typed out. We simply do an import here because we're type safe anyway, and we're done. You might try out the other injections. They help us, for instance, just to generate this part, to generate the enter line in a non-type-safe manner, to generate the enter, just inject in a non-type-safe manner, and so on. In future versions, I will add another set of injections on the fly, depending on my needs. Yeah, you also might send me some patches so that I can add another set of injections on your own. I'm really open here. Just try the plugin, tell me what you like, tell me what you don't like, send me bugs, send me patches. I'm happy about everything. In fact, I'm trying to gather your users because I really would like to have people using my stuff, but also have in mind, don't be rude, be polite, because I'm really doing this on my spare time here and sort of in between a stressful day job and my family. Sometimes things might take a while to get fixed, but they will be fixed. Okay. Yeah, now we have the first service. We now quickly make a delegate to access all this. Get, say hello again. Now we have the service wired in. We now can use the type ahead functionality of IntelliJ. And since we are type safe and everything is typed, we easily reach say hello automatically. We forgot a return type. That looks good now. IntelliJ needs a little bit to catch up, but it will. Yeah, we forgot the return as well. It's a little bit early. I haven't had my first coffee yet. Still in the morning. Yada, yada, yada. Okay. Then I don't like to type in here. Let's quickly fetch the entire template. I've seen that, I've shown that before. It's really just a keyboard shortcut or a mouse click. And then let's quickly add this controller. Say hello. No, we have saved that. And that's hello from my first service. Isn't it a beauty? Is it, right? Of course, more complex logic is possible. We can push our client-side business code into our first service. This was sort of a Hello World demonstration. But I used that stuff for really complicated stuff in my bigger application, which I cannot showcase because of NDAs, of course. And yeah, it works. And you might like it. I hope so. Of course, all the stuff I've shown to you also works from an Angular 2 point of view. I have everything wired in for Angular 2. I will showcase that in a later video, but for the time being, we are going to stick with Angular 1 for this video series. Yep, we are done with this part. Now, I think we are going to make a longer video today. As I said before, we are now trying to do some REST stuff. So what does it mean? We have to touch Java for the first time in this video series, except for the project generation. And here, we already have a Spring Boot starter installed, which is done automatically by the Spring Boot plugin. And we also have to stick with Spring Boot because, as I said before, in the first video, I have some tooling for GE, but my day-to-day work revolves around Spring Boot. And since it's a tool developed by me for me, I develop what I need. So if I need something, it has higher priority than something which is nice to have. You definitely can work with GE, but you will lose some functionality. And so I'm going to make this demo for the time being with Spring Boot, and I don't think I will extend the GE support before 1.0. Maybe there's a better one in 2.0. I'm just in the middle of the planning phase. And if somebody wants to send me a patch or whatever, then I'm happy to integrate it, yeah. So let's go to the Java side now. Let's close this one. Source main. Oh yeah, we are a little bit too deep here. Here, we're in the Java folder. I already have implemented in one of my tests. I did a video before, but I ran into a bug which I needed to fix. I've already did a REST folder here, which was not deleted by reverting the project. Let's reuse that one and create our first REST service. Now, here we have the functionality create REST. There, at the moment, we only have the entry create a Spring REST controller. Let's click this one. And we are here now at the special dialog. Create REST controller. Let's make it a little bit smaller. It doesn't matter anyway. We now give it a service name. First REST service. Ah, yeah, that's is one thing I'm going to explain. We have to give it for the time being here prefix with REST. This part is auto-generated by the calculate REST path functionality, which we have in other parts as well. And we want to create the Angular REST code as well. We use the Angular level tiny decorations. Because we have a tiny decorations project, this is a limitation. I do not have a full auto detect on this level here, because the plugin allows to create Angular 1 and Angular 2 directories separately, and you can fill the artifacts in both directories. But for the time being, we have to stick with the tiny decorations level here. And then let's generate it, yeah. And after that, I will quickly explain why I added the REST prefix here. Now, we are choosing a folder where we dump in our TypeScript part of the services. This is module 5. We want to add the files to Git. Now, the TypeScript part is generated. Then we also can go here back and forth between TypeScript and Java, like we can do it for the components. Here, we need a little bit of formatting, but it's also generated. So yeah, and let's go back to TypeScript, then let's quickly have a look at the underlying module. The service is registered in the provider section of the ng module. Okay, what does this REST prefix mean? That's sort of a limitation of my code at the moment. If we go back to our Angular part and look at the config, this part here, the client runs at the port 4200. If I start Spring now, let's do it quickly. It will take 2 or 3 seconds. Now we're done. It's on port 8080. So what does this mean? If the page issues now a REST call, it usually goes back into the same port where the original page comes from, which means 4200. For the time being, for development, we don't want that. Maybe once you're in deployment, you want to pack everything together, it is nice to have it. So we need a configuration which allows a REST call to map back into the port 8080 to hit our separate Spring server, which is in fact an embedded Tomcat running in a Spring boot jar and whatever. You may be aware of this. Okay, let's go back to our configuration and look at the webpack config now. Here we have this proxy setting, which is also derived from what the Angular 2 tools did. And this proxy means whatever call comes in with the URI prefix REST is mapped down to the port 8080. So what does that mean now? If we have a REST call here to the port 4200 with the prefix REST, it's mapped down to the port 8080 with the prefix REST. We are going to see that later. So let's go back to our first service. Now, what about the REST endpoints? We could write them manually again, typing. Then let's water a little bit our RSI if we already have one. Yeah, whatever. Seriously, we have some stuff here which helps a little bit. This is the functionality create REST endpoint. But before creating that, let's create it first. We might come to the next part after that. We create a simple REST endpoint here. Say receive hello. Let's call it receive hello. We just using get here. Let's use post or put. Post is fine here because we just sent data. Return type, of course, is void. The Angular level is still tiny decorations. Create TypeScript mapping if possible. That's okay with me. I really want to have this TypeScript part created instantly. And the REST path, of course, is already auto-calculated. We don't have to take care of that anymore. Now, what are we going to see here? We haven't seen that before. The reason for that is we already have created the REST service. We have the endpoints on the TypeScript side as well. And we want to add that. But usually, I'm not going to auto-add something unless it's the modules, configurations, and so on. For the code itself, I leave it up to the end user to change or take whatever he or she wants. Because usually you might want some late fixes, you want some naming and so on, and I think it's always better to leave the last operation to the user here. And I talked to several people and they said it was a good idea, so I'm not really that off here that auto-generation is not really wanted here. So what I'm doing here is that I just move the things over via the integrated IntelliJ diff editor, which is very flexible. You can edit here, you can type here, but for the time being, we just use accept here. That's it. Now, we're on the receiving end here with our annotated REST controller. This is a set of annotations which goes beyond what Angular 2 has. And that basically says we have a REST call here. Our service, of course, is RESTable with a base path. And the sub-URI is receive hello. So whenever we call this method, a REST request is issued with which tries to call the REST endpoint receive hello. Yeah, that's it. Let's quickly do something here. Just something lazy. Again, a hello world, like we haven't had any in the last 20 minutes or so. Okay, now I have to restart, unfortunately, my Spring server, you know, Java. Yeah. Okay, let's go now to the TypeScript part. Just copy this method call here. And then let's go to our page 5 and make this call. Again, live, I haven't planned anything. I forgot to integrate this into our injections. Let's make a TC here. Yeah, we need that one. Change the order because that was the last one I was using. Makes sense. Okay. Now we are here. This point. First REST service. Receive hello. Then blah blah. We ignore whatever comes back. We don't have anything anyway. And then alert. Service called and returned without errors. Yeah. Yep, we have to give it a value. In this case, really any, because we don't have anything. And there we have it. Okay. I was in Java yesterday too long, so yeah, that should be okay. Yep. Now we're here. And works. Service called and returned with without errors. If we look at our debugging console, hold on a second, where is it? Our run console, here is the hello world. So yeah, that's it. We have our first REST call. But what and how, what happens if things become more complicated? That's easily doable. Let's go back to our first REST service and let's create a generally more complex REST endpoint. We need a complex return value here. Let's quickly create a Java class. My call it my, oops, sorry, first DTO. Let's make it generic. T value. It's a really complex one. And we add getters, and we want to use an all args constructor. Yeah, make it private. So now we create another REST endpoint here. Really complex stuff. Get really complex stuff with a get, and we want to have a return value of myFirstTTO of type string. Sorry, jumping between languages can cause this. We don't want to have a list here for the time being. And yeah, let's generate it. Now our div edit this back. In this case, we just want to map it. As you can see here, the myFirstTTO already is mapped. String has been mapped to TypeScript string. And we have the REST call here. Yeah, perfect. Just take it as is. Now, we don't have the DTO yet defined on the TypeScript side. So what we have to do now is we have the functionality DTO generation from source. We just use that one. Now we select our module here and generate it in. Now, as you can see here, everything is generated. The generics are properly mapped. And we have an implementation class where we can dump our code in here. The reason for that is this part here is more or less the JSON representation of the values coming in. The values are JSON. So that we are type safe for the compiler on our side. But if we need custom functionality and we would put it in here, it would be lost because we only get JSON data. What we can do is we can use this implementation class, and the DTO annotation takes care of the transfers of the values which we dump in here, so that basically after that we have the value here set. And here we can fill in our custom code, we can add setters, getters, we can add custom functionality on the fly whenever we need it. So if you need custom functionality on your transfer data, you really have to use this implementation class and take care that it's not overwritten. Okay. So now here we are missing an import on our end. Or not? Yep. We have to go to the TypeScript part here. And we have a Java problem here as well, as it seems. We are missing the return value. Let's quickly return a value and then we are taking care of the TypeScript part. Return new myFirstTTO. Hello from really complex stuff. Save that one. Go back to TypeScript part. Now we're missing an import here, but now that the DTO is generated, we can just use the standard tools here. And we're done, as you can see here. Yeah, now let's give this call a chance. Go back to our page. We could use that one as well. Yeah, it's better, I think. And then let's change that one. Get really complex stuff, which then receives data of type. And now we can see of type string. If you look at the really complex stuff, we already have this here, but that's not resolved by IntelliJ. So we have to type in that manually. But now we're type safe. Whatever we do, we can use the IntelliJ functionality and the compiler will scream as well. And let's quickly add something here. Complex hello of type string. And then this.complex.hello is data of value. And now we just have to wire it in. And something is not working. Ah, yeah, we have to restart. That's also a common pitfall. You wire something in, then you forget about something, which means we forgot about restarting our Spring server. There's Spring tooling in play. There's a Spring tooling which restarts all the stuff automatically. That's the Spring developers tools. I have not wired them in because once the things become a little bit more bigger, sometimes it can become slower that you restart the server. So there's other toolings in place which can help you replacing the classes on the fly and so on, but they're all not perfect or really expensive if they're perfect. But I leave it to you on the proper configuration. You can add the Spring Dev tools, for instance, and then you have a proper restart every time you change something. Yeah, it's really up to you. Okay, now we have restarted the server. Let's quickly reload the page. And here is the result of our REST pod. So, how about parameters? That can be done as well. Let's quickly go back to our Java part. Let's quickly add a path parameter. It's called path variable in Spring. Let's give it a proper name. This is important because after compile, the names get wrangled. You can have the p parameter to still keep the name for whatever reason, but yep. I always prefer to have it named. My param of type string. You can use path variables, you can use request parameters, you can use request parties outside of get requests. I want to have a get request here. As I can see, post is not really the one I want to use here. Sorry. That was the wrong one. The really complex one it is. Here we are already on get. Then my param is path parameter. Then the path variable annotation. Param string my param. And now we are going to pass that into our first CTO. So we now have to adjust the REST endpoint. Again, service generation from source. Now things have slightly changed, as you can see here. Wrong syntax. I can see it here now. So this one it is. Now it's perfect. Service generation from source. We're here now. Get really complex stuff. A path variable is passed with the myParam as being the parameter. We don't have to take care of anything else anymore. And that's it. We are going to accept the changes here. And let's quickly go back to our service, or our page in that case, because the method name stays the same, but we now have an enforced parameter. We are going to add hello from client. We are going to restart the REST server again. And here we are. This part has been pushed forward from the client down to the server, and the return value is a JSON value which returns this one. I think let's quickly have a look on what is passed here. I'm not too familiar with the Firefox tools, but let's have a look at the response here. And as you can see here, a proper JSON is passed back and forth. We use the standard functionality which Angular provides on the client side here underneath, and we use the standard Spring REST functionality which basically does the JSON mapping for yourself. I think that's it for this video. Not quite sure what we're going to do with the next one, but I think from a video state point of view, I'm now at the level where I can start to tag version 1.0. So I think version 1.0 will be tagged within the next days. Yeah. And other videos will be added over time, but I won't rush that anymore. Yeah, thank you for your attention and have a nice day. And I hope you really will enjoy the tools I've programmed. And I'm happy to get feedback from you. Thank you for your attention and have a nice day.